حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله
Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him he born in humans to be the best and give his best religion to them Allah our God is the greatest the one and only glory to him السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Praise be to Allah alone. We all praise Him and we seek His help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, none can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Brothers and sisters, welcome to a new edition of your program, Gardens of the Pious. In this series, there is a special edition on Hajj, and that is the fourth episode in this special edition. Today, inshallah, we'll begin this episode with a hadith concerning the virtues of the greatest day of the year, the day of Arafah. And the hadith is narrated by the mother of the believers, Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her. She narrated that, أَنَّ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ مَا مِنْ يَوْمٍ أَكْثَرَ مِنْ أَنْ يُعْتِقَ اللَّهُ فِيهِ عَبَدًا مِنَ النَّارِ مِنْ يَوْمِ عَرَفَةٍ رواه مسلم. Aisha, may Allah be pleased with her, narrated that the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, said, there is no day on which Allah sets free more slaves from hellfire than he does on the day of Arafah. The hadith is a sound hadith collected by Imam Muslim. And it means simply that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala releases and frees most of his servants, both men and women, from hellfire on the great day, the day of Arafah. We're talking about millions of pilgrims. And other than pilgrims as well. Because the day of Arafah, its greatness covers both those who are on the day of Arafah, happen to be in the valley of Arafah to perform Hajj, and others who are not blessed enough to perform Hajj, there is also some virtue of them, of that day for them. Like if they happen to fast on the day, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that it forgives the sins of the past year and a year to come. While fasting on the day of Arafah is not prescribed for the Hujjaj, for those who perform in pilgrimage, because they need the strength, they need to eat, to drink in order to keep their strength so that they can carry on the rituals of the day, the ibadat, the dua, and traveling afterward to Muzdalifah, and so on. You need a lot of water, at least if you're not hungry, not to get dehydrated. Al-Hadith also says that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم said, on the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ينزل إلى السماء الدنيا فيباهي بهم الملائكة. So on the day of Arafah, this virtue is specially for those who perform in Hajj. Allah the Almighty descends by Himself. And again, the question of the manner, how, Allah the Almighty knows best. But since the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he does so in this hadith, and similarly in another hadith, when Allah the Almighty descends to our worldly heaven, every day, whenever it is the last one third of the night, and he calls on those who are in the prayers, making dua, saying, is there anyone who is seeking forgiveness? So I shall grant him forgiveness. Is there anyone who is asking for any need? So I shall fulfill his need. Is there anyone who is making dua? So I shall answer his dua. The manner of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to our holy sky, and whether he descends by himself or he means otherwise his mercy or whatever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. It doesn't really concern us because we have not been informed. So our manhaj in this regard is to believe that yes, Allah the Almighty descends. How? He knows best. He did not mention to us, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not explain to us how does this happen. What matters is why? Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do that? Whether on the last one third of every night, or on the day of Arafah, which is the subject of our hadith. On the day of Arafah, يُبَاهِي بِهِمْ مَلَائِكَتَهُ Allah is very proud of the pilgrims of this huge assembly, the greatest annual gathering on earth. Millions of people. And millions of people of those whom Allah invited. It have nothing to do with being rich or poor, a king, a president, or a guard, or a driver, or a maid, or a janitor. It doesn't matter. Only by invitation. You've been invited, then you're there, you're eligible for Allah's mercy. يُبَاهِي بِهِمْ مَلَائِكَتَهُ Allah the Almighty is proud of this gathering, this huge assembly on the day of Arafah before His angels. You know that al-Malaika, when Allah informed them that He's going to create Adam and He's going to make His successors on earth, إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً قالوا أتجعل فيها من يفسد فيها ويسفك الدماء ونحن نسبح بحمدك ونقدس لك They said, Ya Allah, why would you create such creatures who are going to create mischief and corruption on earth and cause plenty of bloodshed? On the day of Arafah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the angels, look at my servants. Look at the human beings. Those are the believers. Those are my chosen servants. Look at them. أتوني شعثا غبرا. They come to me. Look what they are wearing. Look at the hair, the shriveled. That's why it is not recommended to comb your hair and wear the makeup. No, it should be in this form where you show Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the maximum humility and humbleness. Shu'than, with their hair, the shriveled. Ghubran, they're covered with dust. Doing what? يَرْجُونَ رَحْمَتِي وَيَخَافُونَ عَذَابِي They're hoping for my mercy. And they're afraid of my punishment and torment. وَلَمْ يَرَوْنِي In another narration by Abd al-Razzaq, it says that the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah the Almighty will say that to the angels. Look up my servants. They came شُعْثًا غُبْرًا hoping for my mercy, afraid of my torment. All of that even though they haven't seen me. فَكَيْفَ لَوْ رَأَوْنِي What will be their behavior if they actually see me? They're doing that, they're hoping for my mercy, afraid of my torment, even though they did not visualize me. They could not see me. What if they can actually see me? Then he mentioned the rest of the hadith. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Allah the Almighty will say to his angels, bear witness that I have forgiven them all their sins. All their sins. Imagine, and I hope this episode will be aired during or a couple days before the day of Arafah, during Hajj, so that those who are going for Hajj truly appreciate the day and understand that this is not a field trip. This is not some sort of outdoor camping. No, you're going to reform. You're going to be reborn. On the day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at you, He descends to our holy heaven and He talks to His angels and He's proud of this gathering. And He says to them, bear witness that I have forgiven them all their sins. The foolish one is the one who would miss this opportunity by challenging Allah the Almighty on the day by committing sins, even by observing minor sins. If you consider smoking a minor sin, why would you do it on that day? Why would you challenge Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by wasting your time in vain talk or obscene language? Why would you like to be excluded from Allah's mercy? While He is descending His mercy upon the whole gathering. You know the angels will say, when Allah the Almighty say, bear witness that I have forgiven them all their sins. The angels will say, but such and such person, he had loads and loads of sins. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, he too is included. Because he has come to Allah with sincere repentance. Not challenging Him with disobedience and with sins on that great day and the great place. Be ready. Be prepared for the day. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincere dua for forgiveness. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with sincere repentance. Because you know what happens. If on the day Allah forgives you your sin, you're the most successful one. You know if it happens that the person after finishing the day of Arafah and gaining Allah's forgiveness, then expiring. If he dies, he goes straight to heaven, subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us such great honor to be forgiven and to be admitted paradise. Allahumma ameen. In the seventh hadith, which is collected by Bukhari or Muslim, narrated by Umar ibn Khattab, may Allah be pleased with him, that a Jewish man came to him when he was the leader of the Muslim Ummah, when he was Amir al-Mu'mineen, the second caliph. He said, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, you guys, you Muslims, have a verse in the Quran. By Allah, if this verse was revealed in the Torah, would have considered it Eid Day, the day of its revelation, would have revealed this verse in the time of its revelation. It has a great significance. Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, asked the Jewish man and he said, and look, when Umar ibn Khattab was Amir al-Mu'mineen, leading this ummah, a Jewish man had the guts to sit and talk to Amir al-Mu'mineen with freedom. He did not force him to become a Muslim, because we should not force anyone. There should not be any compulsion in religion. But rather he maintained his faith. And he was discussing with Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn Khattab an ayah of the Quran. He said, which ayah is it? He said, the ayah which says, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. This is a part of an ayah number 3, the last part of ayah number 3 of Surah Al-Ma'idah, which means, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ, today I have completed for you your religion. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي, and I have perfected for you my favor, upon you my favor. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I'm pleased for you with Islam as your religion. Then Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu said, إِنِّي لَأَعْلَمُ الْيَوْمَ الَّذِي نَزَلَتْ فِيهِ وَالْمَكَانَ الَّذِي نَزَلَتْ فِيهِ. By Allah, I know the day and the place on which this ayah was revealed. It was indeed revealed upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, وَهُوَ قَائِمٌ بِعَرَفَةِ يَوْمَ الْجُمُعَةِ, while he was standing on the day of Arafah, and it happened to be Friday as well. So it's a Eid day. Each Jumu'ah is a Eid for Muslims. And the day of Arafah is the greatest day. Some people consider that if the day of Arafah coincides Friday, then this is called Al-Hajj al-Akbar. La, Al-Hajj al-Akbar happens every year. Whether the day of Arafah is on Saturday, Sunday, Monday, or any day. Al-Hajj al-Akbar, that day refers to the Eid day, Yawm al-Nahr. Some of the scholars and the commentators of the Quran said it refers to the greatest nusuk of the Hajj, which is Arafah, since the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the hadith, Al-Hajju Arafah. It have nothing to do with whether the day of Arafah happened to be on Friday or any other day. If it happens to be on Friday, this is great, because this is a Eid day and this is a Eid day, and both are great days. But would that make the Hajj double reward, triple reward, 10 times more, as many people claim, and they fight to go on that year? We don't have any sound reference that says there is an extra reward, as far as we know, for those who will perform Hajj on the day of Arafah whenever it consigns Friday. So now, brothers and sisters, this day is the greatest day. Number one, there is no other day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala releases, sets free, and frees more people from the fire of hell, of the believers, obviously, men and women, more than on the day of Arafah. More than on the day of Arafah. Which means there is an open sail, an open door to heaven, a wonderful opportunity for those who are serious about going to heaven and saving themselves from hell, to seek that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on that day. Either by performing Hajj and asking on the day of Arafah, or by fasting on that day and begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be amongst utaqa'ihi min al-nar, those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will free from the fire of hell. May Allah the Almighty make us all from amongst them. On the day of Arafah, An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the greatest dua, the best invocation, is the invocation of the day of Arafah. Then he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best dua I made, me and all the prophets before me, is La ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah. So, La ilaha illallah, which is the kalima, kalimatul tawheed, is the best form of dua. If the person occupies his time, her time on the day by praising Allah, sending the peace and the blessings upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, commemorating the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his needs will be fulfilled automatically. Every moment of the day is very valuable, brothers and sisters. In Surah Al-Fajr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears and takes oath to certain things. Swears by Al-Fajr. وَلَيَالٍ عَشْرٍ وَالشَّفْعِ وَالْوَتْرِ. And whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes an oath to something which He created, it indicates its significance and its greatness. الْلَيَالِ الْعَشْرِ, the interpreters of the Quran said, it refers to the days and nights, the first 10 days and nights of the month of Dhul Hijjah. And the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah are the greatest of the entire year. And Al-Shafa' and Al-Watr, they said Al-Watr or Al-Witr refers to the day of Arafah because it takes place on the 9th, which is a witr day, an odd number of the month of Dhul Hijjah. While Al-Shafa' is Yawm al-Nahr, which is the greatest day, Yawm al-Hajj al-Akbar, and the day of offering the sacrifice, and it takes place on the 10th, so it is Shafa'. And this is the view of Abdullah ibn Abbas and many other companions. May Allah be pleased with them. In Surah Al-Buruj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالسَّمَاءِ ذَاتِ الْبُرُوجِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْمَوْعُودِ وَشَاهِدٍ وَمَشْهُودٍ. And I swear by Shahid, and I swear by Mashhood. They said, Al-Shahidu, Yawmu Arafah, Wal-Mashhudu, Yawmu Al-Jum'ah. These two great days, Yawmu Arafah, which is known as Yawmu Al-Itqi Min Al-Nar, the day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala frees people from the fire of hell. The day of Al-Mubaha, on which Allah is proud of His servants before the angels. ما من يوم أكثر من أن يعتق الله فيه عبدا من النار أو عبيدا من النار من يوم عرفة. There is no other day on which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sets free more of His servants from the far of hell more than the day of Arafah. So that day is our prize. That day the believers should be waiting anxiously for it. Those who go for Hajj, they have this thought in their mind. Why am I going for Hajj? Why not Umrah? Umrah is kafara, but the day of Arafah guarantees the erasure of all the sins. Imagine if the person also precedes that day with repentance so that the major sins automatically will be forgiven if you repented as well. And you settle al-mazalim, as we discussed in the previous episode. All the wrongdoing against others, you settle that and you seek their pardon. Then on that day, huququllahi azza jal, the remaining sins concerning the rights of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as Allah promised, will be erased and the person will be newborn, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to His angels, bear witness, I have forgiven them all their sins. Allahumma taqabbal. O Allah, make us from amongst them. An-Nabiyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in one hadith which is narrated by Al-Abbas ibn Mirdas, said, on the night of Arafah, النبي or the evening of Arafah, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم kept making دعاء for his ummah بالمغفرة والرحمة فأكثر الدعاء. He kept saying, oh Allah, forgive my ummah, forgive them their sins, oh Allah, have mercy on my nation, and so on. He made plenty of دعاء for the ummah. Then on the Muzdalifah, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم also made دعاء for them. فعاد يدعو لأمته, especially after Fajr and until the daylight. Then all of a sudden the companions noticed that An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was smiling after he made this dua. So they asked him, O Messenger of Allah, what made you smile? I mean, there was no obvious reason. You were making dua and you were very serious. What made you smile? An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تبسمت من عدو الله إبليس. I smiled because I saw the enemy of Allah, Iblis, Satan, when he knew that Allah accepted my dua for my ummah. I have been praying for my ummah. Oh Allah, pardon my ummah, forgive their sins, have mercy on them. So when Iblis figured out that Allah accepted my dua, أهوى يدعو بالثبور والويل. He started praying against himself, saying, woe to me, woe to me. And he picked up dirt and sand from the earth, and he threw it over his own head. فتبسمت مما يصنع جزعه. So I smiled because the way that he was so desperate and he humiliated himself. In the hadith, طلحة بن عبيد الله ابن كريز رضي الله عنه narrated that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ما رؤي الشيطان يوما هو فيه أصغر ولا أطهر ولا أحقر ولا أغيض منه في يوم عرفة. وما ذلك إلا لما رأى من تنزل الرحمة. سبحان الله. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said that Satan was never more angry, upset, humiliated, and disgraced, and disappointed than on the day of Arafah. Why? Because of what he sees of the descendants, the extending of Allah's mercy upon his servants, particularly the Hujjaj. وتجاوز الله عن الذنوب. He's been working hard, him and all his host. He has an army of Satans, all his offspring, working hard throughout the year to mislead human beings, to bring them to hell, to cause them to commit sins, minor and major sins. Then all of a sudden, on one day, with one repentance, on one scene, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erases all their sins. What a waste. This is what Satan says. So there is no other day on which a shaitan will be more humiliated, disgraced, and disappointed than on the day of Arafah. Meanwhile, that is the greatest day for the believers. Do you think it would be proper for those who either perform in Hajj or stay at home to waste their time on the day without making dua, either watching movies, playing video games, playing cards, or doing anything that could upset or displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day and waste the magnificent reward which He has prepared for the believers on the day? It's your call, brothers and sisters. May Allah direct us to choose what is best for ourselves. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. We'll take a short break before we come back for the next segment with some more a hadith on the virtues of Hajj. Please stay tuned. حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته and welcome back. الإمام النووي may Allah have mercy on him listed the following hadith with regards to the virtues of performing Umrah on a specific time, and we would like to share it with you even though it is not time. يعني the hadith is speaking about the virtues of performing Umrah during the month of Ramadan. So we'll discuss it because it was mentioned in this chapter. عن ابن عباس عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنهما أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال عمرة في رمضان تعدل حجة أو حجة معي. متفق عليه. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, performing Umrah during the month of Ramadan is equivalent to performing Hajj or equivalent to performing Hajj with me, with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. The equivalence is in their word. And the hadith is agreed upon its authenticity. And obviously, it doesn't mean that it will serve as a substitute for performing Hajjatul Islam. Hajjatul Islam, which is the fifth pillar of the deen, must be performed when the person is capable. There are some virtuous deeds which the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned. It will provide the reward of performing Hajj and Umrah, such as performing Umrah during the month of Ramadan. Umm Sinan al-Ansariya, a woman from the Ansari companions, did not attend Hajj with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He asked her, why didn't you? She said, we didn't have a ride. We had a nadihan, a camel that we used to fetch water, and the other, my husband took it and my son to perform Hajj. So we didn't have a ride. And Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to comfort her and assure her she still have a chance to get this reward. She said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إذا كان رمضان, whenever it is a month of Ramadan, perform Umrah during Ramadan. This is not only for Umm Sinan al-Ansariya, but this is general for the whole Ummah. Perform Umrah during the month of Ramadan because it will be equivalent as far as it were to performing Hajj with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah is the most generous. Similarly, with regards to an act that a person may do on regular basis and get a full reward of performing Hajj and Umrah, complete reward of Hajj and Umrah, which is praying Fajr and Jama'ah and sitting in the same place, making dhikr, istighfar, and recite Quran until it is sunrise. It is the duha time, 15 minutes past sunrise, you pray two rak'ahs. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, this practice will guarantee you a reward of performing a complete Hajj and Umrah. That does not substitute the mandate of performing Hajjatul Islam. So if the person performed Hajjatul Islam, which is a main pillar, one of the fifth pillars of the deen, and does that on daily basis, whether while performing Hajj or not, he will still get the reward of performing complete Hajj and Umrah. A person who is not lucky enough, fortunate enough, rich enough to perform Hajj or Umrah, can still get the reward by doing this on a regular basis every day. But if the person was not capable to perform Hajj because of physical disability, while he or she had the financial means, then we'll discuss this in the following hadith, inshallah. They must appoint a representative from their own wealth in order to perform Hajj in their state. But here we learn from that there is some superiority for the same deed if it is done on certain times, such as performing this Umrah during the month of Ramadan because of the sacredness of this time, because of the greatness of the season of Ramadan. Similarly, doing the same deed, any deed that the person may do during any other time will be rewarded, etc. reward. But if the person was to do it during the first 10 days of the month of Dhul Hijjah, then it will be greater as far as reward and better. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. But here is a question. An-Nabiyyu sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself did not perform a single Umrah in Ramadan. Rather, he performed the Umrah during the months of Hajj, Dhul Qi'dah, and so on. So, which one is better? To perform Umrah during Shawwal, Dhul Qi'dah, and Dhul Hijjah, or to perform Umrah during Ramadan? For us, for the believers, the best is to perform Umrah during Ramadan, because this is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chose for Umm Sinan al-Ansariya, and similarly for all his followers. But for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah chose for him to perform Umrah during the month of Hajj in order to clarify a very important thing, a great concept. To oppose what the Meccan pagans during Jahiliyyah used to believe. For instance, they used to believe that it is not permissible for the Haram people to perform Umrah during the months of Hajj. Furthermore, they believe that it is not for them to go out to Arafah. Why? They said, Ahlul Haram, they should not go out. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to go out, and the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went out because Arafah is not included in the Haram. Mina is, but Arafah is not. So the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did so in order to remove the traditions of al-Jahiliyyah and to reform and to reinstate the original Hajj as instructed by Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. So, al-Hajju, Al-Umrah fi Ramadan is equivalent as far as the reward to the reward of performing Umrah, performing Hajj along with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now with regards to performing Hajj or Umrah instead of somebody else, and what are the reasons which would allow the person to appoint somebody else to perform Hajj in his or her stead, and whether a person can do that on behalf of somebody who passed away and died or not. The following hadith is also narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas. May Allah be pleased with him and his father. He said, أَنَّ امْرَأَةً قَالَتْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ إن فريضة الحج، إن فريضة الله على عباده في الحج أدركت أبي شيخا كبيرا لا يثبت على الراحلة، أفأحج عنه؟ قال نعم. متفق عليه. Abdullah ibn Abbas narrated that a woman came to the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, and said, Allah's obligation upon his servants has become obligatory on my father. She means by that Fariḍat al-Hajj. But it has become obligatory on my father in his old age. My father is very old and is incapable of riding. May I perform Hajj on his behalf? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said yes. Which means if the person is physically incapable to perform Hajj while he have the means, then somebody else should perform Hajj in his state. Is it permissible? According to the hadith, it is permissible. Now the question remains, is it a must? Well, if the person have the means and can appoint somebody else to go to perform Hajj in his or her state, it must happen. He must do so because he have the means. In ayah number 97 of Surah آل عمران الله سبحانه وتعالى سيد من استطاع إليه سبيلا ولله على الناس حج البيت من استطاع إليه سبيلا. So Hajj is mandatory upon those who can afford it financially and afford it physically. So if the person cannot afford it physically but he have the financial means, then he or she is required to appoint somebody to perform Hajj in their state with the following conditions. Number one, you got to keep in mind that the person whom you're appointing to perform Hajj in your state must have done his or her Hajj first. Did you say her? So a man may appoint a woman to perform Hajj in his state if he's not capable. Or if the man is dead, can a woman perform Hajj in his state? Yes. How come? This is the hadith. A woman said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, my father is due to perform Hajj, but he's old enough that he cannot stand or he cannot stand on a ride. He cannot travel. He's incapable of riding. May I perform Hajj in his state? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said yes. But if a woman is performing Hajj in the stead of somebody else, you know that if she is traveling the travel distance, she definitely needs a mahram along with her. النية. النية is another very important condition, which is النائب, the representative. At the time of formulating the intention of Ihram, he is not performing Hajj for himself. Rather, he's been paid to perform Hajj instead of somebody else. So he should declare the intention that I'm performing Hajj in his or her state. So if the person is aware at the time of making the ihram, he should say, لبيك عن فلان. Here I come to perform Hajj or Umrah on behalf of such and such, and mention the name. What if the person forgot to mention the name? No problem. Why? Because he sat out and he left his house and he put the ihram on with the intention of performing the manasik on behalf of this person. أنا النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم سيد عند حديث رفع عن أمتي الخطأ والنسيان وما استكره عليه. You be pardoned for forgetting. النسيان is the second thing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardons us. If we err, if we forget, or if we do anything because we're being forced to do it. Like there is life threat for instance. So a person forgot, no problem. But if the person deliberately said لبيك حجا أو عمرة, and he did not even intend to do this Hajj on behalf of this person who paid him for it, then this Hajj is only for him. And the person who paid did not get anything. Because of that, النيابة, the representation in Hajj and Umrah, you must make sure that you ask somebody who's trustworthy. You choose an honest person who would really perform Hajj properly, as if he or she performing Hajj for their own selves. And would not skip the nawafil, would not skip the wajibat, and tend to give the fidya instead. No, they like to do everything as if they were doing it for themselves. The second condition, that the person who is asking a representative to perform Hajj in his or her state, that is the third condition, must be incapable. So being busy, if a person is running a big company, owns a hospital, is a big surgeon, and he's always operating and making money and running this big corporate, and say, I don't have time to go for Hajj. This is not an excuse. Can I send somebody? I will pay extra. No, that's not valid. This Hajj will not be valid. It will not be accepted for you. For him, yeah, but for you, no. Why? الحج عبادة بدنية ومادية ومالية is a bodily and a financial worship that the person must perform by himself, like the prayer. Can somebody pray in your state? No. Can you pay somebody to fast in your state? No. Similarly, الحج only in the case of being incapable, having physical disability, not being able to travel. In this case, you may, it is permissible to appoint somebody. But if you have the means, it becomes compulsory, not just permissible. Another condition, the disability is continuous. Because some people happen to have some sort of acute diseases, acute pain, temporary, but it is not chronic, it's not something that they live with. Somebody who experienced DVT or was in a cast or a disease which is expected that he will recover from this disease in a few months, in a couple of years, then you cannot just simply ask somebody to perform Hajj in your state. And if you do, then you have to perform Hajj once you recover. Why? Because you're not permanently incapable. Some of the scholars even said if the person was permanently incapable, then he recovered, a miracle happened, and the person became capable, then he must perform Hajj. But the more right view, according to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal and his school of thought, then if he had asked somebody to perform Hajj, to represent him in Hajj, while he thought that he will not recover and his ailment is lasting, is sufficient. He doesn't have to do it. If he does it, fine. Otherwise, he's not required to do it because he did what he did when he was assuming that it will not be possible for him to travel to perform Hajj. The following condition is very interesting and it is worth of discussing because you hear this a lot. Some people say that the representative himself must perform Hajj from the same hometown of the person, al-asil, the original person. And others said, at least must perform Hajj and assume the intention of ihram from the miqat of this person, which means they dismiss any representation in Hajj. If somebody is living in Mecca or living within the miqat, and somebody would give him a call and say, I will pay you that much and perform Hajj in my state. Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and others said the person must perform Hajj from the place of the original person. There is actually a difference of opinion in this regard. And Alhamdulillah, Allah gave us ease. So I would like to present the easier view in this regard, which is also adopted by Shaykh Ibn Uthaymeen. May Allah have mercy on his soul. He said, it doesn't matter. What matters is the actual act of worship, ihram, tawaf, سعي عرفة then طواف الإفاضة and سعي الحج and طواف الوداع. So even if the person is living within the miqat, not before the miqat, even if the person is living in Mecca itself, it is valid if this person can perform Hajj instead of somebody else, and that will be a lot safer because you know you don't have to pay him the airfare traveling from the States or traveling from Europe, which costs a lot, and all the means of transportation, you're just paying for the local package. So this is an opinion I'd like to share with you. It is valid, according to many of the scholars, including some of the recent scholars, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, may Allah have mercy on him. It is permissible, and the person doesn't have to go back to the original miqat of the sick person or the dead person. No, rather from any miqat which suits you and it is required for you to assume the intention of ihram from, since you are the one who's performing Hajj. So now we mentioned five conditions. I hope that we keep in mind whenever we do Hajj al-Badal. Or asking somebody to represent you in Hajj. Or asking somebody to do Hajj in your state. The following hadith is narrated by Laqit ibn Amir radiyallahu anhu in line with the same subject. أنه أتى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال إن أبي شيخ كبير لا يستطيع الحج ولا العمرة ولا الظعن قال حج عن أبيك واعتمر رواه أبو داود والترمذي وقال حديث حسن صحيح. This companion whose name is Laqit ibn Amir, may Allah be pleased with him, and his father. He came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, my father is a very old man and does not have strength to perform Hajj or Umrah or to undertake the journey. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, perform Hajj and Umrah on behalf of your father. And that shows us this is a confirmation of the previous hadith without any further clarification. I rather can take advantage and discuss one more hadith before we wrap it up. السائب بن يزيد رضي الله عنه قال حج بي مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في حجة الوداع وأنا ابن سبع سنين رواه البخاري. السائب بن يزيد was 7 years old when his parents took him for Hajj with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. That was during حجة الوداع. I was 7 years old when I was taken to perform Hajj. This was during the first time, during the time that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed Hajjatul Wada'. And this hadith is a sound hadith collected by Imam al-Bukhari. There is another hadith which we discussed before during the chapter of At-Ta'awunu 'ala al-Birri wa al-Taqwa. The hadith is narrated by Abdullah ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. When he said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam met a caravan in a place called Ar-Rawha and asked who the people in the caravan were, they replied, "We are Muslims." They asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Who are you?" He said, "I am the Messenger of Allah." Then a woman lifted up a boy to him and asked, "Would this child be credited with having performing Hajj?" The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, yes, and you will have a reward for performing Hajj and assisting him to perform Hajj. You will be rewarded for that. The hadith is narrated, is collected by Al-Imam Muslim. So this hadith, along with the hadith of As-Sa'ib ibn Yazid, indicates that it is permissible to take the youngsters, the children, to perform Hajj or to perform Umrah. And the second hadith indicates that the person, whether it is the guardian, the father, the mother, or whoever, is taking the child, carrying the child to perform Hajj and walking him or her through, will also receive a reward for that. Will the child himself receive a reward for that? Yes. But the child is under the age of puberty. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, رُفِعَ الْقَلَمُ عَنْ ثَلَاثِ. The pen does not record the actions of three, and he counted الصَّبِيُّ حَتَّى يَبْلُغُ, the child until he or she attains the age of puberty. But that is only concerning the bad deeds. But the good deeds will be reported and recorded for them. So they will benefit of this Hajj. But they will be required to perform Hajjatul Islam once they reach the age of puberty. This is the opinion of Al-Jumhur. Some people misunderstood the view of Al-Imam Abu Hanifa and thought that he prevents the children from performing Hajj. While this is not the case, rather he says that if the child performs Hajj, this is as a form of training. Yeah, he will be rewarded for it. But if the child committed any of the restricted acts of Ihram, like wore his regular clothes, cut some hair, or wore some perfume, the guardian or the person who's taking him to perform Hajj is not required to give fidyah because he's just a child. He's not required to give fidyah or pay a ransom for any of these violations. While al-jumhur are of the view that if the child is mumayyiz, knows what is going on, he must abide with all the rules and regulations. And he must make the intention, إحرام and put on the إحرام clothes and so on. If the child is غير مميز, doesn't know what is going on like a baby, then in this case the father or the mother would say لبيك عمرة on my behalf, then لبيك عمرة for my child while you're carrying your child. Put on the إحرام clothes on him or her and take them with you for tawaf, for sa'i. I always say, nowadays, because of the excessive crowd and the construction and the expansion, avoid bringing the babies and infants, especially those whom their mothers are breastfeeding them. They cry a lot and they get suffocated because of the crowd. Especially some parents take them all the way to the Kaaba and to the Black Stone. So if you happen to take them with you, avoid the crowded areas. It will be sufficient to perform tawaf on the second floor or in the handicap area for the safety of your own child. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed parents to take their children, and the companions used to do that, to take them to be trained to learn how to perform Hajj. What if the child, before the day of Arafah or on the day of Arafah, attained puberty? The girl experienced her menses. The boy, for instance, witnessed our dream. The vast majority of the ulama said that then that will count as Hajjatul Islam, because while on the day of Arafah or before, he has become an adult, reached the age of puberty and became baligh. Al-Imam Malik said no, and some other scholars said no, because he started this Hajj as Hajjun Nafila, voluntary. Rather, you should have started it from the beginning with the intention of performing fard, but it was not possible because he or she were still children or under the age of puberty. Brothers and sisters, there is plenty of ahkam which will be discussed in our program Ask Huda, inshallah, during Hajj and after Hajj. I understand that we'll spend several weeks the after Hajj follow-up questions about what happened, and if there is any penalty or ransom, we'll be more than happy to do that. But include us in your dua and pray for the whole ummah. May Allah unite us. May Allah make us strong believers. May Allah keep us all steadfast on the straight path. May Allah accept our Hajj and Umrah. Allahumma ameen. And may Allah cause us all to die in a state of Islam. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. حج مبرور. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
حبيب الله رسول الله حبيب الله Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. He born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them. Allah our God is the greatest, the one and only glory to Him. Born in humans to be the best and give His best religion to them.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about it in paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling the best with the cheapest price.
So why did they ignore that? Forgetting all about hell and paradise, worshipping cows, fire and stones, selling their best with the cheapest price.
Rasulullah, Habib Allah.